Hello, everybody. Welcome to today's presentation. We're going to take a couple minutes to just have everyone get themselves situated into the room and just having the opportunity to just listen to this lovely music as we get started. But, you know, we're just going to start off with a couple of things, and I'll talk more information about the webinar being recorded. And then at any point, if you so wish, you can provide your questions or comments throughout the webinar at any point. You have the option of putting it within the chat box or within the Q&A box. And we will have a question and answer session near the end. So we'll just give everyone just a couple more seconds to stream in. I think if someone is checking, I think we have all the panelists and everyone in the group in today. So we can now begin our welcomes. So good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to welcome you to the community presentation on the Framingham Local Rapid Recovery Plan, or LRRP. This great work is being done in conjunction with the City of Framingham, the Downtown Framingham Inc, and the Metropolitan Area Planning Council, and the Massachusetts Department of Housing and Community Development, or DHCD. My name is Raul Gonzalez. I'll provide a little bit more of an introduction later on in our day, but just wanted to, first of all, thank you for joining us and appreciate you learning more about the work that we've been doing and continue to do through this particular rapid recovery plan process. So as I mentioned earlier, this is a recorded event. So the webinar will be recorded, and MAPC may choose to retain and distribute this video, any images or audio, or the chat transcript that's being provided. So by continuing with this virtual meeting, you are consenting to the participation in a recorded event. You were asked previously if that was something that you would consent to, and the recordings and chat transcript will be considered a part of public record, as MAPC and this event in particular are a public agency and a public event. So just moving on to the next slide. So today's agenda will start with a few brief introductions. I will then provide more information about this project, and particularly the role of DHCD and MAPC in this, as well as moving on to Sukanya Sharma, who will provide some of the key data points of the downtown study area. I will then talk about some of the key takeaways from the downtown business survey that was distributed last month, followed by my review of the downtown study area through a site assessment. And then we'll follow up by fielding some of your questions, which you're more than welcome to submit at any time. And then I'll go over some of the next steps. But first, I'd like to take the time to introduce Dr. Yvonne Spicer, the mayor of the City of Framingham, who will provide us a welcome to the city. Good afternoon, Dr. Spicer.
Good afternoon. And I just want to be able to say thank you to all of our partners for this amazing program that is going to help our small businesses in the downtown. Particularly, I want to reach out to the Commonwealth and say thank you for this initiative, local rapid recovery and program, which does nothing but help not only Framingham, but Ashland and Natick as a part of this partnership. I also want to thank MAPC and Downtown Framingham Inc. for their continuous partnership in order to improve our cities across the Commonwealth, but more importantly, looking here in Metro West, how we can recover, how we can prosper, and some of the other initiatives that we are doing as a city and listening to our business. So that has been a critical component, is making sure that we are listening to the needs of our businesses, but also how are we responding to those needs? And we have done our part thus far in helping with small business grants, but this is another part of this is looking at marketing and technical assistance that may support the growth of a lot of our businesses. Here in the city of Framingham, we've done some other recovery things around reducing fees in order to support some of this work. And we'll continue to do that as we go forth. This is a partnership and a partnership that we will continue throughout the recovery, but also looking at all of the opportunities that we can help our businesses continue to grow and prosper here in Framingham. So I thank you for taking time out of your day to be here, to listen, to learn, and ask some critical questions. And also, I'm interested in making sure that we have the data from our survey to be able to move forward. So thank you, Raul, and I'll turn it back over to you.
Thank you so much, Mayor. So our next introduction will be from Anthony Lucivedo, who is the Executive Director of Downtown Framingham Inc. Hello, Anthony, how are you?
I'm doing well, Raul. Thank you for the introduction. It's great to be here with you all, and very humbling to be introduced alongside Mayor Spicer, and as well as all the MAPC folks and the people from City of Framingham. This has been a really great opportunity for the City of Framingham to interface and the folks at MAPC to interface directly with business owners and see how we can all work together to come out of the pandemic stronger than before. My role at Downtown Framingham Inc., otherwise known as DFI, because it's a mouthful, I interface directly with businesses, residents, and the city government, helping to make Framingham a place where people want to live, work, and play. That's our tagline. And this is very exciting study to see take place. I would echo what Mayor Spicer has already said. It's going to be extremely important to learn how we can innovate in this new normal and see how we can, again, come out of it stronger than before. So I would yield back my time to Raul, and I hope you all enjoy the presentation.
Thank you so much, Anthony. I appreciate that. So let me just tell you a little bit more about myself and my organization. My name is Raul Gonzalez. I am an economic development senior planner for the Metropolitan Area Planning Council. I am also the co-lead of the equity team within MAPC. So MAPC, if you are not familiar, is a regional planning agency that serves the people who live and work within the 101 cities and towns within the greater Boston area. Our mission is to promote smart growth and regional collaboration. A part of our team we have here today is Sukanya Sharma, our regional land use planner, who will be presenting in a little bit. But we also have Will Dorfman, who's our economic development planner. I also like to take the time as well to thank the members of the Framingham Rapid Recovery Plan team. That's Erica Jerram, Hannah Voigt, Gretchen Damore, and Ala Abusala from the City of Framingham, as well as, of course, Anthony Lucivedo and Alex Paiva from Downtown Framingham Inc. And I'd like to extend a special thank you to our UMass interpreters in both Portuguese and Spanish, Rafael, Elena, Carla, and Alisa. We do want to make sure that our efforts are always incorporating the myriad of wonderful languages that are spoken within Framingham. So we always want to make sure that in this process and in continuing processes that we have this interpretation available. So I'm just going to go a little bit into just some of the agenda regarding the local rapid recovery process here in Framingham. So just some background information. It is funded by the state through DHCD to help communities develop plans and promote business recovery and resilience, particularly in light of the COVID-19 pandemic and the after effects of it. It is currently a 5-month planning process to conclude in August of this year. The focus will be on downtown Framingham, of which I will provide a map showing the study area that we are focusing on. The facilitator will be ourselves, MAPC, will be the consultant for the project. And the final product will be us working with project partners, as well as members of local businesses and key stakeholders and within the city and the downtown Framingham area to produce a final plan with clear goals, strategies, and funding recommendations. The plan will be sensitive to organizational and staff capacity to secure and implement funding. And this is very important for us to denote as well. Some of the goals through the project, we have are split between short-term goals and mid to long-term goals. Within the short-term goals, we're going to evaluate relevance, participation gaps, and effectiveness of available programs to develop a response to unique needs of business owners and evaluate impact over time. We also plan to recruit partners who can offer tailored and accessible technical assistance. And we will also develop additional two-way communication strategies between the city staff and small business owners. Through the mid and long-term process, we plan on establishing programming that promotes sustainability during the next phase of COVID-19 and encouraging growth through recovery. We also plan to expand private-public partnerships between the city, nonprofits, private entities, as well as any other key stakeholders to this process to provide programming and support. So lastly, we do plan on offering strategies, particularly within the next two phases, that help businesses diversify their products and perception within the marketplace, especially in this so-called new economy. So just a schedule of this program, we do have between March of and around now, should be more early to mid-May actually, is the phase one of the diagnostic phase. The activities really are the launch, a business survey, which I'll talk about a little bit more, and baseline data collection, of which Sukanya will provide more info on. The deliverable will be data submission to DHCD and public presentations of the findings, which that is today's event. Within later in May to June, we begin the phase two component, which is the creation of recommendations. We'll be doing community outreach, particularly to local businesses within the study area, particularly businesses within the main sectors of the study area, as well as businesses that are owned by business owners in particularly the Portuguese-speaking and Spanish-speaking realm, as well as any property owners within the area, as well as the city staff and licensing. We will also do project development and consultations with experts through this process, and we'll draft a project recommendation. Lastly, in phase three, we'll have the final plan, which will be based on the outreach findings and guidance from partners and continued stakeholder engagement. And then, of course, the creation of the final plan in August. So I just wanted to go over just a few of the plans that we utilize to influence this process, particularly to focus on things that have already been created through the city and, of course, the town when it was a town, and throughout the year, so that we have something that is wholly a Framingham project. And of course, our work with the city and with DFI definitely to further that effort as well. So we use the 5-year consolidated plan, as well as the annual action plan, the bike and ped plan, particularly for the downtown area, the downtown Framingham transit-oriented Action Plan, the Housing and Action Plan, and the Master Plan for the city, or at the time, the town as well. So just taking a look at the study area, we provided a map for you all to see right here. The study area is for downtown Framingham. Generally, it includes Union up to the Medical Center, Concord Street up to Clark Street, and Waverly up to Beaver Street. But generally, it is that area, particularly where there is a connection between Waverly, Concord and Hollis, and of Union and Concord, of which the Framingham MBTA station is located, as well as multiple storefronts alongside those two areas. So we're going to jump into a quick poll about downtown Framingham. You should see shortly a Zoom poll pop up asking you, and here it is, what is your favorite thing about downtown Framingham? Just taking a look at that study area and just your knowledge of the geography, I'd love to hear just what your responses are to this question. You can select only one item from this list, so please be knowledgeable of that. And I'll give you about a minute to select. The options are walkability, diversity, location, open space, business variety, food, and shopping. So it seems like we have all the votes in. So let me share the results, So Kanya was able to share the results for me. So it seems that we have more voting for the business variety in downtown Framingham, as well as the food. It's definitely something I can vouch for as well, as I did my site assessment, which is definitely one of the greatest boons about downtown Framingham. This is followed by the location and the diversity of the downtown Framingham area. So thank you so much for providing your thoughts on this. And I'm just going to minimize the poll in front of me. And now we'll be going on to Sukanya, who will talk about the study area data.
Thanks, Raul. So yes, I'll be talking about some of the demographic data that we collected so far as part of this program's diagnostic phase. This was data that, in addition to this, these are some of the highlights, but we also collected some more data, and this was submitted to DFCD. This data is helpful for us to understand the customer base of the region. And we collected this data using a combination of sources like census and other platforms like Esri Business Analysts. In terms of geography, and you see on that small key map there, we have the downtown Framingham area, which is our LRRP study region. And then there's the town. But in order to have one intermediate geography so that we can understand who are the customers immediately around the area, we used a 1 mile radius with Concord and and Union Ave Street as intersection, that intersection as a center. So if we look at the geography of 1 mile radius, and of course the LRRP area, we are looking at around 20,000 people within the 1 mile radius who have a slightly less smaller household and disposable, median household and disposable income as compared to the city itself, which is around in the order of 84,000, while within the 1 mile radius, it is 50,000. The median age in the LRRP area is also lower, so we are looking at a younger demographic than the median age of the town, for instance. And then there's this interesting retail leakage surplus factor that shows the local retail of the area that has and whether it has enough supply to not only meet the local residents, but also attract shoppers from outside the area. So the more more negative this number gets, the more it means that the retail is serving a larger pool of external shoppers than local shoppers. And ideally, it will be great to see this number get more negative, especially within the LRRP area, because that means that downtown is attracting shoppers from just outside the just a small area that downtown is in. If we go to the next slide, we also collected some additional demographic indicators around customer base that might have a broader set of needs. So for example, here we see around 2,000 households within the 1 mile radius with at least one person with disability. There's also 12% of the population living within the 1 mile radius, which is around 2,400 people, reported that they don't speak English well or at all. So this information is just helpful for us to get more context, but that said, we acknowledge that this data can only show a part of the picture. It can be used as a guide and only in conjunction with the broader context. If we go to the next slide, we also collected some more data around the business environment. And this was done by utilizing the site survey, the site visits that were done from MassDOT data, and of course, help from DFI and the city. So we counted a total of 143 businesses within downtown Framingham, out of which 7 were vacant, which is a low number. Thankfully, we were able to weather, the downtown was able to weather the COVID storm in to some extent, given the vacancy numbers are low. We also looked at additional information around the traffic, parking. We using various secondary data sources, counted 922 parking spots on and off street, including, and then of course noted the administrative capacity and a steward organization within the region, which is the Downtown Framingham Inc. I think after looking at this data, we have some understanding of the region, but we continue to build on whatever existing studies we have. And this is one of those, this presentation is one of those opportunities where we would like to understand further what the challenges are, etc. Now I'm going to give it over to Raul for the following slides.
Thank you so
and
much.
We have a poll coming.
Yes, thank you so much, Sukanya. So this part is, we'd like to get to know you a little bit better. So if you can answer the Zoom poll as to who you are representing today, that would be really excellent for us to hear. You can select more than one option if needed. I mean, some of us are wear multiple hats in the work that we do. But you know, if there's anyone that's a property owner, business owner, manager of a business or staff, we'd like to know, as well as if you're a resident, a public employee, or a patron of the business that are businesses that are located within the study area, that would be great. And of course, there's the option for other if you do not fall under any of these categories. I'll give people a couple more seconds. We can definitely wait for a couple more people to provide their answers. So I was trying to find the Brazilian classics YouTube video that I had on earlier, but unfortunately I X'd out. So we do not have the lovely waiting music that we had earlier, but c'est la vie. We are now at 100% of people who voted. So it seems like most of the people, or about half of the people who voted, actually represent other, though there are a couple of residents, public employees, as well as one of each of the other categories, except for staff, that are here on the webinar right now. So thank you so much for providing your thoughts. So just moving on to the next slide, I'm going to be talking about the business survey summary. So the business survey was something that was done earlier in April of this year. It had a bit of a quick turnaround time and was done for all of the local rapid recovery plan municipalities in Massachusetts. We received for Framingham about 17 responses from local businesses, of course, within the downtown Framingham study area. 59% of the respondents had five or fewer employees, that is, they were a small business. And the top categories for the respondents of the survey were generally other, which actually was the largest component of respondents, followed by retail, healthcare, food services, and then personal services, which is you know, things that could be hair salons, nail salons, or any other type of personal service industry. About 65% of the respondents of the survey said that they rented their space. That is, they did not own their space, but were actually renting it. Going into the survey summary, in particular, focusing on the effects of COVID-19 and the pandemic to local businesses, 59% of businesses reported that they were operating at a reduced capacity, either through hours or had closed for the process. 54% of businesses generated less revenue in 2020 than they did in 2019, which is about, you know, a little over half. 59% of businesses had less on-site customers in January and February of 2021 than they did before COVID, showing that there's still a bit of hesitation in returning back to normal, particularly earlier this year. And what is a jarring number, but not one that is, I would assume, surprising to many, about 94% of businesses are reported being impacted by COVID. Most impacts included reduced hours capacity. 65% said decline in revenue. 47% incurred expenses to implement safety measures, that is, getting PPE and getting things such as plastic dividers, things of that nature, or even you know, different types of things for outdoor seating or heat lamps. And then lastly, 41% established alternative modes to sell and deliver products, which actually the last two items that I was mentioning were actually under this category. So not surprising, but still something that is important for us to know. So just another question within the survey itself, are businesses satisfied with the environment? What district revitalization strategies are businesses interested in? Really just thinking about the Framingham, downtown Framingham study area. 41% of businesses indicated that the regulatory environment poses an obstacle to business operations. You know, there have been issues, particularly as people were, businesses were put into different types of regulations during the pandemic and post-pandemic, you know, or during, you know, this part of the pandemic, for them to really try to be as seamless as possible is definitely something that has posed an obstacle to some businesses. 59% of businesses expressed interest in receiving some kind of assistance. Most interest was expressed in participating in sharing, marketing, or advertising, or low-cost financing for purchasing property in the district and training on the use of social media. That was something that we thought was an interesting thing that was brought up from the survey. So just moving on, before we move on to our next item, which is the site assessment, I wanted to pose a question to you all relative to visiting downtown Framingham. Taking you know, into account the map of the study area that we provided earlier, how often do you visit? Do you visit daily, a couple times a week, once a month, or, you know, never? You can select one of the options that are in the poll that just popped up. And I'll give you all a minute to respond. So it looks like we may have one straggler here answering the poll. Probably give you all a few more seconds if available to provide your answer. All right, so just going into the results seems to be pretty frequent of which individuals are going to downtown Framingham at least two or three times a week, but some, you know, four or six times a week or even daily. So that's actually, you know, really good to hear that that downtown Framingham is very much utilized, and you know that the study area is one that is frequented by the community. So thank you for your responses. So next we're going to go into the site assessment review. So the goal of the site assessment was really to understand the physical conditions of the area and to identify both best practices and areas for improvement. You know, it's also an opportunity for us to share information about the study with business owners, letting people know about the goings on of the project, as well as just learning about the businesses in particular. When it was done was the last day of April of last month, or the Friday, which was the last day of the week. It was done from 9:30 a.m. to 5 p.m. Pretty much the process, which was done by myself, involved me going to Union Street, starting up past the gas station that's located on Union Street, getting closer to the hospital, and walking down to its connection to Concord and Hollis, and then crossing the street and going back up to the end of the street to review the other side. I then went to Concord and went down all the way to Hollis as it turned slightly right, and then returned back, and then went to Waverly Street and did the same process up to the beginning of the bicycle area and back, and concluded at the other side of Waverly Street. As you can see here within the map, of which actually was a real-time map of the assessment that I did. So what I did was break it down into three geographies. I thought that was the best format to do this, simply because I believe all three streets and areas had different and unique components. For the purposes of what we submitted to DHCD, we did merge them and provide them the information on an averaged basis, but for the purposes of today and for just really letting people know about the site assessment, we're doing it within three distinct components, of which the first one, as I mentioned, was for Union Street, from the pretty much near the gas station all the way down to the light by Concord Street. So some of the strengths that I had noticed within this area, there seems to be a great number of window grade, as well as you know, the facades seem to distinctly identify and have uniformity, particularly the closer you got to Concord, on what the businesses were and how they began to kind of connect with other downtown businesses by having that uniformity of brick, of font within the signage, as well as the constant Downtown Framingham Inc. banners that were on these streetlights that to me really stood out as being very, very nice to look at and bringing in more of the downtown feel. The crosswalks particularly seem to be fairly new and of high quality, and I saw them being utilized quite often within the area. I think the traffic also was just very connected to what you would picture a downtown area, both street and pedestrian vehicle and pedestrian traffic. They also had great storefront windows and facades, as I mentioned, throughout the study area. And, you know, quite frankly, it looked like a really nice area to go shopping and window shopping in, especially. Some of the challenges, I really didn't see many dining opportunities. Something that we should take with a grain of salt, because it was the day after some torrential rain happened, if you can recall, the Thursday, April 29th. In fact, you can even see within the picture that the clouds are barely starting to break up. And of course, because of the pandemic being still prominent, there you would see fewer people, you know, trying to be mingling with one another. You know, there were quite a few benches, quite a few beautifully set plants and flowers in the area, which were really nice to look at, but very few people were there interacting, I think, because the weather was not as to the degree as one would want to enjoy the outside, being, of course, Massachusetts. There was also a limited number of wayfinding signage for pedestrians and bicyclists. It was actually, this is probably going to be a common theme throughout. For bicyclists, there were sharrows on the road, and essentially that was all I noticed. For pedestrians, of course, you know, the sidewalks were pretty ample and designed nicely, but there really wasn't much signage for them. In particular, it seemed to be more focused on motorized vehicles to review signage that's available, parking signage, things of that nature. And of course, there was a bit of a construction of a site nearby that diverted a sidewalk around it. But of course, that's something that's temporary, and something that I think, you know, would no longer be the case at the conclusion of the study or sometime thereafter. Just going on to Concord Street and Hollis Street, which I think is two streets that connect at Waverly. I pictured here, so you can see that the clouds are now starting to break up, is some of the beautiful benches and plants that are located throughout the area. I felt that the sidewalk presence here was pretty ample and very modern and well-maintained. There was actually, out of all the businesses that offered food service, there was one business, which I believe was a Vietnamese restaurant, that had outdoor dining set up at that time. Of course, this is in the early afternoon, so it probably is not something that is as common earlier in the day. And again, because of the weather, probably would not be as much of an option as it could be in the summer. But that was something that still had ample sidewalk space in light of having something like that. So that was actually a great boon to the area. There were multiple street trees, plants, and benches, as I mentioned, as well as, of course, a park area for a couple of parks along the route to add more benches and more seating and trees and plants. The signage for businesses was very common and very prominent, and easy to differentiate one business from another. It was not as uniform, particularly, as the ones on Union Street, but it was something that was still very very common and very prominent. So something that one can definitely notice from either walking from the other side of the street or from your vehicle. Challenges, this, you know, within the midday was starting to get a lot more congested with vehicles. Most of the wayfinding was pretty much solely for vehicles and very little for pedestrians and bicyclists, of course, other than the crosswalks that were located there. But generally mostly, and of course the sharrows, but it was mostly for motorists as well. Then going into Waverly Street, of which I did an additional assessment of, really the strengths that are there is the fact that it's right by the Framingham MBTA station that's there, the commuter rail station that's there. Quite frankly, there were extensive awnings, which was one of the criteria located within the DHCD site assessment document. But challenges, I don't think this is anything that one would be a stranger to. It is a very car-centric area. There were some dedicated bike lanes, but they began past South Street. So bike lanes would essentially just begin and be dedicated within that road. The sidewalks were generally narrow and spotty at times, whereas bicycle and pedestrian signage was fairly limited. And the windows and facades were vastly different from business to business. Most businesses were fairly set back, of course, focusing more on vehicular traffic than pedestrian traffic or even bicycle traffic, mainly being a more auto-focused street, especially compared to the other two streets that I reviewed. So really now, I think, you know, taking in that data that's been presented and just kind of thinking about the overall project, and that is, you know, the local rapid recovery plan, we wanted to go over just some of the questions that you may have, particularly on the data that was provided, on the site assessment, or even the business survey, and if there's anything about that that surprises you or something that quite frankly, doesn't surprise you, that it's something that should be elevated to our attention. Anything else from that data that you think is worthwhile to let us know, hey, this is something that we should focus on a lot more, is really helpful for us to learn. And, you know, any challenges relative to this program, and, you know, we want to think about this program specifically, so, you know, not, you know, something that's not relative to what we just presented, but really focusing on what we just presented and not something that could be something outside of it, is something that we would like to talk about through this question and answer session. So if it's something that's like, well, you know, there's a pothole that's located in my neighborhood, which is, you know, not even relevant, is probably not going to be helpful given the fact that we're just really focusing on the local rapid recovery plan for downtown Framingham and the study area that we displayed earlier. So I'm going to just stop sharing my screen and ask for Sukanya, Anthony, and Erica, and Will to start sharing their video if possible, just so that we can have the questions and answers session. And maybe it might be a good time, Erica, I know we're a little bit off the cuff, but for you to introduce yourself for this component.
Sure. My name is Erica Oliver Jerram. I'm the Deputy Director for Planning and Community Development for the City of Framingham. I wear a lot of hats, and I've been working on downtown revitalization for most of the almost 14 years I've been in Framingham. I've seen a lot of changes over the years.
So I think we're going to pass it over to Will to just facilitate some of the questions for us and just really go from there. If there's anything that is focused on, particularly the two components relative to the site assessment and the business survey, I'll be more than happy to answer that. And Sukanya is more than happy to answer on anything relative to the data.
Thank you, Raul. So we have one question. I think this is directed towards you, Raul, asking about where on Waverly Street did you stop for your site assessment? And do you have numbers on either side of the intersection at 135 or 126, which is Waverly/Concord. So just some clarification on what you saw on your site assessment.
Sure. So for Waverly Street, I went to the Tarkasis, and apologies for butchering that name, parish. From there, I headed over past the Burger King that was located I believe there was a Dunkin' Donuts and then the Burger King that came up, which quite frankly, I apologize if I have to use Dunkin' Donuts as a naming a place within Massachusetts, because that doesn't really help. Tarsisius. Thank you. And I'm sorry, the numbers on either side of the intersection at 135, 126, which is Waverly Concord, I'm not entirely sure what that entails, but we did do a count of businesses that seemed to be vacant within that area. So those were the number of vacancies that we counted. And I believe I counted two, maybe three. Oh, landmarks relative to the area from Concord and Hollis. So it was where the Domino's Pizza was located on Concord, heading south. And then I went up to where that car wash was located, because I got my car wash there when I was done, on Hollis, which is to the right, I believe. And then I turned around and headed back towards the beginning of where the Domino's Pizza was. Auto Bright Car Wash. I'm learning quite a bit about Framingham, so I appreciate the corrections. So thank you so much, Susan, for those questions. Will, did you have anything else that should be brought to our attention?
Nothing at the moment. It's pretty quiet. We have up till 3 o'clock blocked off. I don't think we'll be using all that time, but we have plenty of time if any questions come up. So,
yes, Erica, I see you have your hand raised.
I'd like to actually comment on something that I noticed in your presentation. I was intrigued that you called out that 41% of the businesses you surveyed had found other ways to sell their goods. And I don't expect you to have an answer today, but I'm intrigued by that number. And I'm wondering if there's, as you go forward, you can kind of dive in a little bit on that or give questions to us to ask business owners how they're doing that and what they, if there are good ways to expand that to others, or to share best practices with others. So that's that was something that struck me.
I think that's a really very strong point. And one thing that I love doing within the work that I do, particularly working with small businesses, is realizing how strong the entrepreneurial spirit is within our communities. And of course, Framingham is no exception by any stretch of the imagination. Think of it in the terms of, businesses that in some cases, are already struggling with many other issues that are quite frankly very common in the small business community. It's a 24-hour job, including some businesses where they are, immigrant business owners who are not familiar with some of the regulations that exist in particularly Massachusetts and in municipalities. But additionally, the fact that this pandemic struck and was just quite devastating and quite frightening for some time, for businesses to pick themselves up and say, this is how we're going to address the unique situation that we're put in and the unique situations that our specific industry is being put in. This could be retail, this could be service, this can be any other type of business type, and say, this is how we're going to adapt. I think that's the number one thing that, that the entrepreneurial spirit has, is the ability to adapt and to succeed. One thing that I talk about when I talk to local businesses is, the path to success is not you know, one that splits between two options, failure and success. It's actually one where it's a single path that involves failure, 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 success. And the number of times that it says failure, it really depends. But it is really something to keep in mind that our businesses certainly do need assistance and certainly do need ways for us to adapt along with them. But you know that they have really done quite a bit to pull themselves up during this past year and a half almost. And by all means, if anyone from the panel is open to fielding questions or just talking about some of the data points that were brought up, you're more than welcome to do so. Just also want to check to see if there's any other questions from the audience, or if there's anything from the panel or anyone from the group that's also a part of the Framingham team or the DFI team as well, or even the MAPC team, of course.
This just speaks to how thorough you are in your presentation and covered it all in the presentation. I'm looking forward to more on the plan, definitely. You've captured our community quite well.
I appreciate that, Mayor. I was a little embarrassed to say that I had never been to Framingham before this study, of which Erica set me right in my ways. And actually the first activity that I have done since the pandemic, in which I actually went out to the field and of course abided by all regulations, was to go to Framingham and downtown Framingham and do the site assessment. As I joke with the team, that site assessment was a great opportunity for me to fill my belly with the multiple different types of delicious food, both Brazilian and other Latin American cuisines, as well as you know, just really enjoying seeing the slow but sure pickup of local restaurants and bakeries and businesses during this pandemic year. And it's not the last time that I will be in Framingham by any stretch of the imagination. I also wanted to recognize City Councilor Mike Cannon here, who's the chair of the Subcommittee on Economic Development. I appreciate you joining us today. So I wanted to take the last minute or so to see if there are any additional questions, but you know, I don't want to belabor it. Should there be any additional questions, we can certainly field them through our contact information. We'll also provide you all a follow-up email tomorrow, thanking you and of course providing you the contact information. I think that at this point, we can certainly just move on to the next steps component of the slides. And one thing that I would like to just kind of point out, particularly as we send you the follow-up email and you want to contact us, anything that you want to provide relative to one-on-one discussions with key stakeholders within the study area is something that we're definitely open to. But yes, and if there's any opportunities for us to field your questions after this presentation, we're more than happy to do so. And I will put up my contact information both at the final slide, but also within the email that we send out. So seeing that there are no further questions in the chat, definitely. I can just jump into the next slide. So bear with me as I begin to share my screen. Let me just switch my settings and share screen. Can you all see this component? Great. So the next steps is really going to be focusing on the phase two component of this program, which is the recommendations and strategy collection. So this is where we really start to learn, take a deeper dive and learn ways for us to really begin to create some strategies and recommendations for the city through this program. So really what we're going to do is some additional one-on-one interviews, particularly with property owners within the study area, as well as business owners that are located there. And by business owners, we want to make sure that we run the gamut on that as well within the different business types that were identified within the survey, as well as some of the data that we searched, but also really, I want to make sure that we take a deeper dive as well and speak to business owners that are from the predominantly Portuguese speaking or Spanish speaking businesses within the area. We think that that'll be a great opportunity to expand our outreach efforts, as well as, you know, Downtown Framingham Inc, which, you know, has their finger on the pulse of Downtown Framingham and is a great resource and a great partner in this program. And lastly, the City of Framingham, particularly the licensing department, relative to any types of areas of their expertise where we can learn more as to the processes for businesses relative to the licensing department, as well as any other department that we think would be best suited to have a deeper dive interview, of course, relative to this program. As I mentioned, phase two is really going to be focusing on strategy development, as well as the drafting of recommendations. This will be done with, of course, our partnerships, as well as being influenced through some of these interviews and one-on-one discussions. And we do plan on having a community feedback session relative to this phase, just like we had for phase one, sometime in the summer. We'll be more than happy to provide you more information when we select a date for you all to participate. But that will be something that we will, you know, really begin to present on our recommendations and, you know, maybe even do something where we provide a bit of a SWOT analysis relative to how the recommendations can be accomplished, as well as some of the pertaining issues that may not be captured from those recommendations, so that we can definitely make sure that this is as much of a community process as we can possibly make it. This is not something that nor would I ever want it to be something where MAVC is essentially dictating to the city what could or should be done. It's quite frankly something that we want to hear from you. We want to hear from local businesses. We want to hear from residents, and we want to hear from business owners or property and business owners relative to what you think are the strategies and recommendations we should be creating. So, with that being said, I just wanted to do a quick plug relative to MAPC's current strategic plan and regional plan process. We have currently been concluding our Metro Common, as we call, long range plan. It's something that we have created within the last few years, just really thinking about the MAPC region. This plan really is action-based, and, you know, we do set our limits to the long-term period, but of course there are definitely short-term and near-term solutions and action steps as well. But, you know, these steps are for state and local governments, institutions, nonprofits, the private sector, and even individuals to help reach our goals for furthering equity, creating jobs, having housing affordability and access, bolstering transportation and transit, the health, public health of our residents and communities, and many more items. You are more than welcome to provide your feedback as we've created the policy recommendations and are beginning to conclude this process. The link below will take you to that, and I will be sure to provide you that link as well, should you have additional thoughts or comments or questions to incorporate within this. So that's definitely something that'll be open for, I believe, a few more weeks. But of course, if you don't mind answering it, if you'd like to participate sooner rather than later, as we are beginning to conclude this process. So I'd like to take this time to thank everyone, thank Mayor Spicer and the Framingham team and staff, as well as Anthony and DFI and my and the interpreters and the MAPC team as well. Like I mentioned, this is not the end of the process, but it's merely the beginning of the process. Phase one has concluded, but certainly we plan on continuing this process to August. And if you do have additional questions or comments or anything relative to this process that you would like to bring to our attention, certainly if there's something that is overarching about this, the local rapid recovery plan process for Framingham, or any clarification questions that you would like to ask, feel free to contact myself. However, if there's something that you think that is relative to the Downtown Framingham Inc. or the city itself, there's contact information for them as well for you to reach out to. So I would just like to take that last minute to thank you all for participating. And if you have any additional questions, please reach out to us. We don't want to be a stranger at all to you, and want to thank you and hope you have a lovely rest of your week. All right. Well, thank you so much, everybody. Bye.